Where did you kind of set the foundation for the Pet Sounds material? Was that done at your home?
That was done in a place. Where did I live? Somewhere in Beverly Hills, up on that's a weird road called Laurel Way, and I had this view of the city, and I was, and I don't know. I guess I got thinking about, you know, I listened to a lot of records. I had a jukebox there, and I'd play all these records, you know, at night, and I had a lot of time to think, and I just started experimenting with a new thing, you know, a new horizon.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Featured, I don't know, my voice on the top. She's not the little girl I want. I thought was really spectacularly great. I went silent for eight beats because I wanted to try so people would really like boom when the music came back in, it really grabbed them. You know what I mean?
She's not the little girl.
I guess I went through the peak of my orchestrating years by Pet Sounds.
Right.
That's, I think, where it really hit its peak.
Yeah, that was really exciting.
Yeah, it was really quite an album to make, you know, and it really dumped it all out there,
right.
You know?
Yeah.
And it was something that I can listen to, and I listened to it a couple nights ago with my wife, you know, in bed, and I felt like I'd just heard it for the first time. It's one of the albums I've made where it's really stayed right with me, you know, new all the time.
Right.
It's beautiful. I really enjoy listening.
Thank you.
This is a strange rumor that's been going around in some books. Please set it straight. At the San Diego Zoo, when you shot the cover for Pet Sounds, there was a story that Dennis and some of the other guys got thrown out of the zoo because they were kind of tormenting the animals. Any truth to that?
I don't remember. I wasn't part of tormenting the animals.
I didn't think so.
I don't remember that.
Yeah. Did you guys have any input in a cover like that, or was that another one of the covers that was picked? Because that's a great cover.
That was simply us going on location to shoot a photo. You know? Mm-hmm. Pet Sounds, we thought Petting Zoo.
Now that is your title, correct?
Yeah, we suggested that. Yeah.
And you did get the credit for that. At least people know that.
Right.
It's a classic animal.
Gee, I got credit for something.
People may not realize that Pet Sounds was meant to be your pet sound, meaning your favorite sound, melodically and vocally pulled together in one place, right?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, the title Pet Sounds came from Mike Love. He thought of that title for the album. He just drops on me one day. He said, what if we called the album Pet Sounds? And I said, that's a great title, you know? And we went down to San Diego and took the album cover photograph with some lambs. And goats. I think they were goats. We were feeding the goats some apples, some pieces of apples.
Sometimes I feel very sad.
Welcome to episode 12 of my Beach Boys album deep dive series, and today I'm going to be talking about their 11th studio album and an album that many people consider to be their greatest album, if not the greatest rock album of all time, Pet Sounds. Now, Pet Sounds was released on May 16th, 1966. Recording had begun in July of 1965 and carried into April of 1966, which is an extraordinarily long time for an album. But, of course, this was Pet Sounds, and the results were well worth the time it took. Now, unbelievably, it only reached number 10 on the Billboard charts. It did get to number 2 in the UK, but it's hard to imagine this album didn't even make it to number 1. I don't know how that's possible, but it just goes to show what a departure this was for the Beach Boys, even by the standards of today and summer days, summer nights. Now, Brian Wilson has always cited Rubber Soul by the Beatles as galvanizing him to want to make the greatest rock and roll album of all time. And so he set to work, and the way that Brian Wilson has described in interviews, he would put together feelings. He would have these feelings, and he would try to set them to music. He collaborated with Tony Asher on the lyrics, for most of the lyrics on this album, much to the chagrin of Mike Love, who felt he was always being kicked aside by Brian Wilson when it came to coming up with lyrics or collaborating on lyrics for the songs that he was coming up with. But nonetheless, this was a period where people like Phil Spector, like the Beatles, like Bob Dylan, were trying to elevate rock and roll music through the end of the 50s, into the early 60s. Not a lot of people saw rock and roll music as sophisticated or as an art form. In fact, many people were wondering, when is this rock fad gonna die out? People didn't think that, a lot of people didn't take rock and roll music seriously, I'll put it that way. And it wasn't until Brian Wilson started coming up with his mini masterpieces that were on the albums Today and Summer Days, Summer Nights, and then an entire album like Pet Sounds, that people and music critics began taking rock and roll more seriously. And Pet Sounds was such a sea change, even for the Beach Boys, because today you still had some rock and roll like we had from the early Beach Boys. There were still some rock and roll rhythms, some songs that still sounded like the Beach Boys of old. There were car songs here and there. They were still talking about summer, and they hadn't completely abandoned their themes that had kind of brought them the success that they had enjoyed up to this point. And so for a lot of Beach Boys fans, to put Pet Sounds on the turntable was really eye-opening. It was kind of an epiphany, like, I didn't realize rock and roll could sound like this. And I've always said context and perspective is everything. And people who say that Pet Sounds is not the Beach Boys' greatest album, nor is it one of the greatest albums of all time, it's overrated, don't appreciate the context and what rock and roll up to that point had sounded like. And rock and roll in the early 60s, and by early 60s, I'm talking primarily 63 through 65, had been kind of dominated by the British invasion sound. You'd had the popularity of folk rock, which had some success in 1965. But none of that prepared anybody for what we got with Pet Sounds. And I remember even the first time I heard Pet Sounds, my jaw was literally on the floor because I couldn't believe this was the Beach Boys. I'd heard all the hits on the Endless Summer compilation, the stuff that got played on the radio, but I did not realize there was such a depth to the Beach Boys beginning in late 1965 through effectively 1967, before Brian Wilson kind of cooled his jets production-wise. But it's such a different sounding Beach Boys album. It's such a different sounding rock and roll album. And you had elements of like Burt Bacharach, you had some Phil Spector influence here, but you had instruments on here that had never been on a rock and roll album before. You had the French horn, you had flutes, you had the electro theremin, the woo, which had just been used in horror soundtracks, string sections, found sounds like beverage cans. I mean, it was crazy the amount of instruments that Brian Wilson incorporated onto this album. And he used a lot of orchestration, but it was orchestration not in like a Nelson Riddle kind of a way, but in such a different way to create these sound textures that effectively captured the mood of each individual song. And at this point, Brian Wilson was really treating the studio as an instrument. You had the guitar before, you had the drums, you had the bass guitar, you might have some keyboards or piano in there, but never had the studio been effectively utilized as an instrument unto itself before the Beatles and before the Beach Boys and even Phil Spector. So let's get into the songs on this album. I don't want to, you know, spend too much time talking about how great Pet Sounds is, because we already know how great it is. Side one starts off with Wouldn't It Be Nice, which this and God Only Knows were the only songs that I was really familiar with off this album before I heard the entire thing. But Wouldn't It Be Nice is one of my favorite Beach Boys songs. It's got such a naive, tender lyric, courtesy of Tony Asher, but it's got some of the themes that Brian Wilson had touched on before this album about I'd like to get married, I'd like to have some stability in my relationships, and it comes across very effectively with the music. You got the great vocal harmonies. I love at the end as the song's fading out, you've got Mike Love with the sleep tight, good night. The complexity of the vocal harmonies is so exhilarating. The music works so well. You've got that orchestration there, which just pumps up the song.
And hope and pray it might come true.
Run, run, will.
Baby, there wouldn't be a single thing we couldn't do. But we could be married.
Oh, we could be married.
And then we'd be happy. And then we'd be happy.
Oh, wouldn't it be nice?
Bum, 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 bum.
You know, it seems the more we talk about it, it only makes it worse to live without it.
But let's talk about it.
Wouldn't it be
it's every bit as intoxicating as California Girls or Let Him Run Wild. The next song we have is You Still Believe in Me. This has the same lyrical theme as She Knows Me Too Well. It's basically an apology song, but I love the rise and then the fall, the vocal harmonies at the beginning, how they rise, fall, rise, fall. It's structured so well. I love the orchestration on here. All of the instruments work so perfectly to suit this song. It's just a gorgeous piece of music, and I'm going to be saying that about a lot of these songs, but it just is. It's a nice, lovely little ballad. Then we get into That's Not Me, which is where our singer is asserting his independence and trying to find their way in the world. There's so many shifts in mood in this song. It starts out, you've got this very percussive rhythm. Sounds like there's some castanets. You've got an organ that runs all the way through. You've got a great Mike Love vocal, and you've got some harmonies and also some singing in his great falsetto style from Brian Wilson.
I had to prove that I could make it alone now, but that's not me. I wanted to show how independent I've grown now, but that's not me. I could try to be big in the eyes of the world.
All of a sudden the percussive rhythm just cuts out and it's just the harmonies, and it works to such a dramatic effect, and you're wondering if the drumming is ever going to come back in, and it does near the end of the song. But there's so many great moments on here where the drama is just heightened by changing up the instruments or taking away instruments or adding some strings or harmonies. But this is such a great little song, and almost the closest we get to a rock song on this album.
I once had a dream, so I packed up and split for the city. I soon found out that my lonely life wasn't so pretty. I'm glad I went, now I'm glad that's for sure that we're ready. I once had a dream, so I packed up and split for the city. I soon found out that my lonely life wasn't so pretty. I once had a dream, so I packed up and split for the city.
Then we have one of the most quiet, solemn songs on this album, and also one of the most gorgeous songs, Don't Talk, Put Your Head on My Shoulder. It is such a soft song, and I love the string quartet in it. I love the timpani, which adds drama to it. Really, the loudest moment is when you have that timpani banging away. Brian sings it so well. It's one of the greatest moments on this side. It's almost got a sinister feel to it because you've got like the cello, which is playing very ominously, even though it's supposed to be a love song. There's just kind of this undercurrent that leaves you with a sense of unease, or at least it does to me. But I love the song, and it's such a great mood piece. Then we've got I'm Waiting for the Day, which moves in a completely opposite direction. It's a bouncy, happy tune. A guy singing about the fact there's this girl who just got dumped by her boyfriend. She's on the rebound, and he's just waiting for the moment where he can step in and make his move. Very cool song. Brian throws everything, including the kitchen sink, at you with this song. You got the full harmony, the full accompaniment of the Wrecking Crew, the orchestra, everything, all the bells and whistles, and I mean that literally, are in this song. It's just a great uplifting song, and you can't help but get a smile on your face when you listen to it. Just a fun, cool song. Then we move right into Let's Go Away for a While, which is a meandering instrumental, but I do love it because you never know where it's going to go. Again, you got some strings on here, some timpani. I love the vibraphone at the beginning. It's such a cool mood that it sets. And, you know, I think at one point this might have had lyrics, but I'm glad it doesn't because it works so great as an instrumental and one of my favorite Beach Boys instrumentals for that matter. And then right into the fantastic Sloop John B, which was a folk song that Al Jardine brought to the band and encouraged them to record.
Alan is the one who suggested that we do Sloop John B on the Pet Sounds album. Sloop John B was originally recorded by the Kingston Trio, which is this very successful folk group in the U.S. about 1957, 8, and 9 in there.
I feel so broke.
And I'm glad it closes out side one, but it was just a song made for the Beach Boys and their harmonies. And it's got a great arrangement and a very cool way to bring to a close the amazing side one. So side two opens up with one of the greatest love songs of all time, Paul McCartney's favorite song ever. He's gone on record saying it's his favorite song of all time. And can you blame him? This is just a majestic song. There's so many fantastic moments here. You got a great string section. I love the clopping drums. I love at the end how it just builds to this swell of harmonies. I love that section where it just breaks off and the doot-doot-doot-doot-doot-doot-doot-doot just comes out of nowhere. It's like, where did that come from? It's such an amazing song.
God only knows. That's a very spiritual, religious song, you know, with the word God in it. So we had to take it real careful the way we made the music, you know, with the word God only knows. So Tony Asher and I came up with a very clever love song with a very, I may not always love you, you know, kind of melody, you know. We did some prayer sessions for God only knows. We prayed for people and for the goodness, the highest good of people, yeah.
God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, oh, life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me, so what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you.
Should be played at every single wedding, and it is one of the greatest Beach Boys songs, and I know I say that a lot, but I'm telling you, it is just a fantastic song. Then we have the song I Know There's an Answer, which began life with the lyric, hang on to your ego. Mike Love famously refused to sing it because he felt it was a druggy song and didn't want to be any part of that. So they changed the lyric to I Know There's an Answer. But I love the keyboard totally makes the song for me. I love the rhythm. I love like the honking saxophone.
I know so many people who think they can do it alone. They isolate their heads and stay in their safety zone. Now what can you tell them? And what can you say that would make them defensive? Come on, like
many great moments again on this song. I think it's a clarinet right before it gets into the verses again. At the end of the chorus, that clarinet, and things just kind of pause. I love that moment of the song, but it is so very cool. Then we have Here Today with another great Mike Love vocal, and it's got a strident rhythm, and it's got a bit of a marching band feel to it, particularly in that break. Playing off the lead vocal, a great, great song. Then we have I Just Wasn't Made for These Times, which is Brian Wilson lamenting the fact that nobody's digging these new sounds that he's into. Nobody is really on board with the direction that he wants to take music, or at least that's the way it seems. But another gorgeous song. You've got great keyboard work, great bass work. The Wrecking Crew is just on fire. And it's one of Brian Wilson's most majestic moments. I love everything about it. The harmony, again, I keep saying the same things, I know, but I can't help it. The music on this is just otherworldly. Fantastic. Then we get into another instrumental, and this one's kind of, I don't know, it's got some sort of a calypso flavor to it, whatever, but I love it. Just a charming instrumental. It's the title track, Pet Sounds, and I dig the Beach Boys instrumentals. They're so underrated, and this one is no exception. Then Caroline No, which actually began life as a Brian Wilson solo song. I've got the single, and it's credited to Brian Wilson, believe it or not. But again, what a way to close out an album. Another album where Brian Wilson just nails the last song.
Did your long hair go? Where is the girl I used to know? How could you lose that happy glow? Oh, Carolina, who took that look away? Remember how you used to say you'd never change, but that's not true. Oh, Caroline, you break my heart. I don't wanna go and cry. It's so sad to watch a sweet thing cry. Oh, Caroline. Finding you a
This one about a guy who meets up with a girl that he used to know. She looks different. She's behaving different. And he's really mourning the fact that, you know, they have grown apart and he doesn't even recognize her. But it's so cool. The original lyric was Carol, I know. But Brian misheard it as Caroline, no, and the rest is history. Okay, so this video's run too long. I'm not going to show you what copies I have. I've got the 180 gram represses of the mono and the stereo. I've got a cassette copy. I got a bazillion CD copies. But at any rate, what an amazing album. Next time, I'm going to be talking about the album that never was, one of the greatest lost albums of all time, until it was found a few years ago, Smile.